Hello learners, welcome. I'm Dr. Uma Singh and today we shall be discussing a very important and an interesting area of management, that is on principles of management. This is from lesson 10, part 3. You've all heard about principles. They exist in all disciplines and all fields of knowledge like physics, chemistry, law, medicine, accountancy and so on. So just like in other fields of knowledge, similarly, these principles also exist in the area of management. They are referred to as principles of management. So what are principles? Principles are simply the fundamental truths that guide thought and action. In the area of management, these principles form the basis for management theories and they have evolved over a number of years through constant expertise, experience and experimentation. So in this chapter, let us learn about these principles of management. Now this chapter tell you in details about the concept of principles of management, nature and features of management principles, the relevance and significance of these principles, then scientific management, the principles of scientific management and what these scientific management are aimed towards. So let us now start discussing about first the concept of the principles of management. So let us now start discussing the concept of the principle of management. A principle refers to a fundamental truth that establishes a cause and effect relationship among two or more variables under a given situation. For example, in the area of management, we have a principle of division of work. Now, when the work is divided from a higher level to lower levels and the work keeps on getting repeated and the person involved keeps on repeating the work, it leads to specialization. So here it establishes a cause and effect relationship between division of work and specialization. So division of work becomes the cause and the effect of this division of work leads to specialization. So management principles are the basic truths that are generally stated in the form of cause and effect relationship and they serve as a guide to thought and action for managerial decision making. So they are important for managers for the purpose of administering and managing the business. Now these principles are derived on the basis of either observation and analysis, that is the practical expertise and experience of managers, or by conducting experimental studies as we do it in the area of various fields of sciences. Now, what are the features and what are the characteristics of these management principles? First of all, they are universal, they have an equal importance, they are flexible in nature, they aim at influencing human behavior and they have a cost and effect relationship among the variables. So let us learn more about these various characteristics of the management principle. The first among them is that these management principles are universal. That means that they are applicable to all types of organization. So whether it is a business organization or a non-business organization like educational and other non-governmental organizations, and they are also equally relevant for all levels of management. So, irrespective of whether it is higher level, middle level or lower level, these principles have a universal applicability and they are relevant to all different varieties of organization and all types of management levels. Second important characteristic is that they are flexible. So, these principles are not static rules, but they keep on developing and they are dynamic in nature. They can also be modified and applied to the changing situations. Like for example, an organization may be using centralization principle when it was formed. When it was formed, it may be of a smaller size and as it expands, as it grows, it moves from a centralization principle to a decentralization principle. So as a result, the principles also offer the organization to be flexible and dynamic in nature. So, modification and improvement is a continuous phenomenon in the case of principles of management. third important characteristic is that they aim at influencing human behavior. We all know and understand that organizations are made up of and they function through people. So management is all about managing people and managing men in the organization. And when you are managing people, you are actually relating to the human behavior or the people behavior, which is highly complex and unpredictable. So these management principles are directed towards regulating human behavior so that people can give their best to the organization. And management is concerned with integrating efforts and harmonizing them towards a goal. For example, we have a principle of order, which is directed towards that there should be a proper place of orderliness or keeping the men as well as material. This will ensure efficiency, better productivity, and also less of wastage of the resources. So this helps in understanding that the management principles, they influence the human behavior so that they are able to perform better for the organizational efficiency. Next important characteristic of management principle is, which is one of the most important, that is related to the cause and effect relationship. So principles of all management always indicate a cause and effect relationship among the related variables. In the beginning of the lesson, I told you an example about division of work, that how the division of work leads to specialization. So as the worker keeps on performing the task over and over again, as a result, he becomes more specialized and there is reduction in wastage and also better efficiency and better productivity. So here the cause is division of work and it leads to an effect or an impact, which is in the case of providing better specialization and better efficiency. So the principles indicate what will be the consequence or result of a certain action. They specify what the ultimate outcome will be in a particular situation if the work is done in a particular manner. So there is a cause and then there is a direct impact, and as a result, it relates to the cause and effect relationship among the related variables. Then next important characteristic of the management principles are that they have an equal importance. That is, all the management principles are equally important. So none is given preference over the other. All of them have a universal applicability and at the same time they are all important. No particular principle has a greater importance than the other, and all of them are required together for the better achievement of the organizational goals, as they are all directed towards the common objective of improving the organizational efficiency. Having learnt about the various characteristic features of the principles of management, now we move to understanding that what is their relevance and significance of these principles in the organization. Now, the first among them is that they act as a guide for research in management. Now, these principles have been developed, as explained earlier, under various experiences and experiments, and they can be tested in new situations and management practices, which makes them more effective. We also learnt as a characteristics that they are dynamic in nature, that is, they are not static rules, and as a result, the management has to keep on evolving them to suit the situation and also for the overall organizational effectiveness. For example, earlier, in order to motivate your employees and workers, financial incentives had a very, very important role. So all the management could do was to give them more remuneration or give them more wages or give them more salary for the purpose of boosting their morale and giving them motivation. But over the years, the financial incentives are important, but more important are also the non-economic or the non-financial incentives in the form of health, education, or other facilities and wellness programs for the employees. So as a result, you moved from giving financial incentives, and in addition, non-financial incentives have also become all the more and equally important for the motivation aspect of the employees. Second significant aspect about these principles of management is that they improve understanding. That means the knowledge of these principles of management help the managers to administer and manage the organization in a smoothful and a efficient manner, which is not only in the interest of the organization, but is also in the interest of the employees. So as a result, it provides for a better improved environment and also a efficient environment to work in the organization. Third relevant aspect of these principles of management is, and a very important, that it provides for simplification of managerial work. So these principles, the knowledge of these management principles, make the work easy and simple, and managers perform complex managerial tasks on the basis of these principles and make the sound business decision. Later in this chapter, we shall also be undertaking the concepts and understanding about scientific management, where we'll talk in detail about work studies and time studies and motion studies, which helps the managers in reducing the complex tasks to more simplified tasks, which not only helps the employees, but also helps the organization. So an important aspect of principles of management is that it simplifies your managerial and the overall work. Next is that it increases efficiency. So principles are guidelines that are there for the managers for taking accurate decision, and they help the managers in solving complex problems for the enterprise. So as a result, when you have ready rules and guidelines that guide you to take various actions and to administer the management, of course, you are able to take up complex problems in a more simplified manner. So, in a way, it increases the efficiency for the managers in managing the organization. Next relevant aspect about these principles of management is that it provides an understanding to human behavior. Now, management is a behavioral science. It's a complex science. It's a behavioral science because it deals with human behavior. So, the people and tasks that are there in the organization is an important component for the management to understand, because everything is related to either managing men or managing the resources. So management principles help us to understand the human behavior and what can be offered or what can be done in order to satisfy their needs. And once then their needs are satisfied, definitely they will provide for a better efficient work for the organization. Now, having understood about the various characteristics and the relevance of the principles of management, we move on to what is scientific management and what does it aim for and what are the principles of scientific management. An important area in principles of management is scientific management, which was identified by Frederick Winslow Taylor, F.W. Taylor, as he is commonly known, and he is also regarded as the father of scientific management. So, according to him, a healthy management is always related to scientific management. So, what is scientific management? Scientific management means the application of scientific methods of study and analysis the problem of the management. So, according to him, there are certain scientific methods which not only helps in reducing the workload of the employees, but also provides guidelines in how to manage and how to improve the overall productivity for the benefit of both the organization as well as the employees. So, the scientific management is the art of knowing exactly what you want your men to do, and then seeing that they do it in the best and the cheapest way. So this is what F.W. Taylor had defined as scientific management. That is, the managers should be apt at knowing what you want your employees or people to do, and then you identify the best and the easiest way of accomplishing that particular task. And in that manner, you would be able to improve their productivity and also the efficiency of the organization. The entire emphasis of scientific management was to determine one best way of doing a job, selecting the best person for doing the job, training the best person on the most efficient methods of performing the task, and providing sufficient monetary incentives. So this was the crux of what F.W. Taylor had identified as scientific management, that there is always one way which is the best way for doing the job, then selecting the best person for doing the job, because we all have different interest and different specialization. So you, as a manager or as the organization, you should be able to identify that which is the best person who suited to accomplish that particular task. Then you train that best person so that he performs the task in the best possible manner, and this will of course lead to better monetary incentives for the worker or the employee, and also in improving your productivity and efficiency. Now, for the purpose of accomplishing what the scientific management had suggested, there are certain principles given by F.W. Taylor. Now, these principles are science, not a rule of thumb, scientific selection, training and development of workmen, close cooperation between the workers and management, mental revolution, maximum prosperity, and sixth is division of responsibility. So now let us learn one by one in detail about the principles of scientific management. The first principle is science, not a rule of thumb. So what this principle is stating is that we should not stick to routine task or routine way of doing things. Rather, we should keep on evolving and experimenting with new techniques, because as a result, when we experiment and when we evolve in new techniques, definitely we'll be able to improve our way of working and of course contribute towards the overall organizational effectiveness. So according to this principle, decisions should be based on facts rather than on the rule of thumb. So rule of thumb means past experience or routine or traditional approaches, and Taylor stressed and emphasized that each job should be based on the scientific method of study. So in order to accomplishing a particular task, he also suggested a way of performing the task, which we learn in greater detail when we move on to the techniques of scientific management, where he talks about a work study in respect of time study, motion study, fatigue study, that there is a particular scientific method of accomplishing a task in the most efficient and an effective manner. Second principle that was laid down by F.W. Taylor was the scientific selection, training and development of workmen. That is, if an organization wants to improve the efficiency, it is necessary that the people or the workers must be appointed with due care scientifically on the basis of job analysis and job description. What he meant was that every work before it is allocated must be studied in detail in respect of the authority, responsibility and tasks that you want to accomplish through that particular work. And similarly, in order to accomplish the task, it is also necessary that you list down that what abilities and skills and other aspects you require in a person to accomplish that task. So a job analysis and job description describe in detail about the job to be accomplished as well as the skills and abilities that you require in a job holder. And the employee should be allocated the work according to their ability and interest. So this will create a sense of enthusiasm among the employees and a feeling of belongingness. So when the employees are allocated the task in terms of their abilities, their interests, their talents, they will have a sense of accomplishing the task in a better manner, and also it will inculcate a feeling of loyalty and belongingness to the organization. So in a way, it will be helpful again for the employees as well as the organization. The third principle that he stated was a close cooperation between the workers and the management. Now, this is a very important principle, that there has to be a close cohesiveness, a close harmony among the workers and the management to carry out the managerial task and the managerial work. If both of them work in a different direction, what will happen? It will lead to unnecessary conflicts, unnecessary clash of interest, and as a result, the defined activities or the defined task for which the organization is existing, the goals and the other objective which it needs to accomplish will not be accomplished, and the entire effort will go in just those conflicts and that disharmony that is created. So what he suggested was that both of them must work in close cooperation so that they are able to accomplish the plans and standards for which the organization is existing. And there must be proper cooperation and a spirit of mutual cooperation and a spirit of mutual harmony among one another so as to carry out the task in a better and a amicable manner. Another important principle as suggested by scientific management is mental revolution. Now, what does mental revolution means? Mental means something related to behavior and mind. And what is revolution? Revolution means some kind of a big change. So, mental revolution implied that the workers and management should have a complete change of outlook with respect to their relations and work effort. So, there has to be a complete changeover. There has to be a complete change, a big impactful change in terms of your attitude, in terms of your behavior, in terms of your relation. And this is again important so as to inculcate a spirit of togetherness among both the workers and the management, wherein they should realize the importance of each other and should work with full cooperation. And this is a very, very important principle which requires for a complete changeover in terms of your attitude, in terms of your behavior, in terms of your outlook. So again, as to fulfill the organizational goals and the objective for which it is existing. Next principle is the principle of maximum prosperity. And this principle aims that every management should be able to secure maximum prosperity for the employers and the employees. And this is possible only when each worker is given the opportunity for maximum output rather than restricting their output. So what this principle is trying to explain to us is that you should provide for the maximum development for both the employer and the employee. So, there should not be any restriction in terms of any conditions imposed, because then it restricts the ability of the worker to perform well. So, in order to extract the maximum, it is essential that the organization must be flexible and must be open in giving the maximum prosperity for the employer and the employee. This will all not only result in better labor productivity and the overall improvement in your organizational efficiency and effectiveness, but also ensure that the worker is more loyal and has a sense of belonging to the organization. So, in the long run, it will always be useful and beneficial for the organizational survival. Next principle is division of responsibility. This principle suggested that there should be a clarity between the responsibility of the management and the workers. Responsibility, what is responsibility? That the tasks that have been allocated to you, you have a sense of responsibility and accountability for those tasks. So he very clearly distinguished between the aspect that generally in the organizational working, there are two aspects involved. One is relating to the planning of work, and the other is relating to the implementation or the execution of the task. And he very distinctively categorized the fact that the planning of work should be the responsibility of the managers. So all the decision making must be in the hands, or they should be made responsible. And how it is to be done, how it is to be implemented, how it has to be executed must be left out to the workers. So there was a clear distinction in terms of division of responsibility so that you are able to make them accountable. So once you know that you are responsible for accomplishing this particular task, identifying the accountability also becomes easier. So the planning of work was given as a task to the management, and the implementation or its execution was for the purpose of the workers or the employee task. So the aim of scientific management, that what ultimately through these principles it is trying to achieve in the organization, is increase productivity through greater efficiency in production, reducing the cost of production, eliminate wastage in the use of resources and methods of manufacturing, right men for the right job at the right time, and giving incentive wages. And as a result, you will realize that when you are managing your organization through these scientific principles, definitely it leads to better accomplishing of the task and better productivity of the organization. So in this chapter, what we've learned is we learned about the principles of management, the nature and characteristics of these principles, what significance or relevance do they have for the organization, and then we also learned about in detail about the F.W. Taylor's scientific management, what were the purposes or aim with which scientific management was propagated, and then what are the principles under which the scientific management operates. So I'm sure with this discussion and learning, you would be able to understand and appreciate the chapter better. Thank you very much.